Begun. Hey, Southside Sox, this is Keelan Ballou, and I have a special guest today. This is Dr. Meredith Wills. She's currently working as a sports data scientist, but originally had a PhD in astrophysics. She also recently won a Sabre Analytics Research Award in 2019 for her work on researching baseballs, and specifically MLB baseballs. And also, she does a lot of knitting and works in partnership with both the Baseball Hall of Fame and the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum to create reproductions of vintage baseball sweaters and some other work. So thank you, Dr. Wills, for coming here today. I really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me. I'm making a little fun here, but the PhD in astrophysics doesn't expire. I do still have it. It's kind of cool, even if you don't work in it anymore. Just the way you phrased it was funny.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Yes, right, she has right. It permanently. Yeah. There's not a...
They don't rescind them if you stop doing astrophysics.
It hasn't expired yet.
Nope, not yet, not yet. At least I haven't checked, but I don't think it has.
Yeah, you might get stopped, pulled over for that.
Something like that, yeah. My scientist card is around here somewhere, but I don't know where.
We have a scientist in the house. We've got a doctor in the house.
Oh man.
Kind.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I used to have a t-shirt actually that said not that kind of a doctor.
I mean, yep. I would trust you more than a lot of medical doctors, honestly, so far.
Yeah. I can think of some.
Oh. Yeah. Well, yeah, I would love to hear, you know, I guess first kind of how you got on your journey to sports from your still existing PhD in astrophysics.
Oh man. I get the question a lot, but I do enjoy it. It's fun. I need to go back farther. My dad has, you know, his entire life, huge baseball you know, he played in college. He probably would have done like the kind of Cape Cod League stuff nowadays, but that didn't exist. He was good. But he was a Milwaukee Braves fan for the entire existence of the team, which for those people, you know, Hank Aaron was part of the Milwaukee Braves for their entire existence. So he was one of the guys that my dad watched, you know, growing up into his adulthood. And I was born after the Braves went to Atlanta. I was born the day that the day that Hank Aaron tied Babe Ruth's home run record.
Oh, wow.
It was also opening day. So his first child is born on opening day. And it's the day that this amazing ball player he's watched his entire life ties the greatest home run record of all time. Okay. The greatest MLB home run record of all time. Sorry. I need to give O his credit. But he went out, he bought me a baseball bat the day I was born. He was absolutely convinced that I was going to be something in the game. My birth announcements, I love this, it's a little girl and her diaper, you know, had the pink hat and stuff with the ball and the bat. My parents got a lot of congratulations on the birth of your baby boy because it didn't dawn on people, despite the pink and the little pigtails that, you know, only boys play baseball, right? But I was 3 weeks old when he took me to my first game. I've never not been in baseball. I love astrophysics, but I didn't start being an astrophysicist till college. So it's always kind of a fun question because, like, you know, the obvious thing is how do you go from astrophysics to baseball?
Yeah.
And it's, you know,
the other way.
I came back to baseball, but there hasn't been much room for being a scientist in sports at all until pretty recently. So, you know, so I did I now work as a data scientist, you know, looking at ball and player tracking stuff, like, you know, when I'm not studying baseballs, because that is my own separate independent research, but, you know, you gotta get paid to do something, right?
Yeah.
And yeah, it turns out that what I did in astrophysics has a really strong overlap with the kind of ball and player tracking that we'll see that, you know, that you'll see StatCast do. So the stuff that I work with, you know, is the tech that, you know, we now see with StatCast. And so it's actually, you know, pretty cool. It turns out that astrophysics is a perfect crossover that way. And I was able to go back to what I love. I mean, I guess I love the astro too, but it's really cool to like be a scientist and be in baseball. And then in the last few years, I somehow ended up learning a lot more about baseballs than a lot of people.
Yeah. And we'll get into that. I am curious if there was a specific moment, or if just always, you know, there was an idea when you were working with astrophysics, if you were like, this could be applied to baseball, or if that was something you were already aware of.
Actually, it was, I mean, there was a sort of a moment, which is, I guess I can think of sort of two things. I had really just started getting into interest in SABR, and the first conference I went to, Corey Schwartz, who's actually BAM's VP of Tech, was at the, it was just a regular SABR conference. This was before SABR analytics conferences existed. And I was told there was someone from MLB who was there who I should talk to. At the time, it just had to do with the scorebook thing I was working on. So it sort of made an interesting entree. But, you know, there was this one MLB guy who might be worth talking to. Nobody seemed to know who he was or where to find him. And I ended up in a talk there where they were talking about, you know, what I guess is BAM now. I don't remember what it was called at the time. It was pretty new. And I got up, you know, with the mic where you're, you know, there's like a line for questions. And really, I just got up and did a rant about blackouts. And you know, how
nice.
This idea of watching games with blackouts and, you know, the insanity of it, if you had no, because I lived in a place where, you know, I couldn't have gotten the TV anyway. And it turns out Corey Schwartz was sitting right next to me, like literally on the aisle right next to me. So I was mortified. And I, you know, it was an interesting situation because, you know, we hit it off right away, which was great. But, you know, enough so where he was a huge support. Yeah, so Corey, I'm saying a lot of good stuff. It's all true. But he knew that I was interested in player tracking, you know, sort of as an idea before anything was being done. And he got in touch with me about, you know, FieldFX, which interestingly enough is now exactly the tech that I work with. It's what StatCast uses is a different company. It's a different technology. But I should say the technology itself is the same. It's just a different corporation doing it. But, you know, he actually got in touch. He's like, yeah, there's this thing that's coming out that's we're going to have in a couple of years to do player tracking. And immediately, because everything I'd done in Astro, it's all spatial and it's all like, you know, time dependent. It's all movies. But it's frankly a lot more complicated than having, you know, individual, like all the players are separate things. You know, right. I was literally looking at like, you know, plasma. It's essentially ionized gas with magnetic fields in it. So it's more dense and less. It's cool. It's beautiful, but it's really complicated.
Yeah.
So it's like, oh, look, all the players are different, you know, and they're like individual things. You know, it's not like you can have a half a player.
Right. Ideally. Floating around.
Yeah. So, cool. But yeah, so it's, you know, and it just turned out to be a great, it took a while to sort of find the right place because I felt like I turned out to be a little ahead of things, but that didn't turn out to be a bad thing either because, you know, sort of able to just, you know, felt like I've made up a lot of my own rules, I guess. I don't mind.
Yeah. That's awesome though. I mean, mm-hmm. You've definitely found a niche here with everything lately. So yeah, I mean, I would definitely, and I think listeners would also love to hear about your work. Know what you've done lately or just even historically, especially your work with balls, but really anything.
Well, I mean, the baseball stuff's the most interesting, you know, and that was one that you mentioned the knitting before and the partnership. And I hate to say it, that's a bit in abeyance right now because I keep finding things with the baseballs on the science side. So, you know, what I've been doing with it's still there, but I just haven't done nearly as much with the Hall of Fame in the last couple of years, unfortunately. But I've been a knitter actually since I was 5 years old. So baseball's longer, but not much. And, you know, I'll do knitting design. So I'll have, you know, a couple patterns published. It's on average, it turns out a couple a year. And I realized that the yarn inside baseballs, in fact, here, you wanna see yarn from inside baseballs?
Yes.
Well, I'll start with this. So, that is the cross section of the inside of a Major League Baseball. And you can see there's like, it's a little harder to tell on the edges, but there's actually three layers. There's like this, there's one out to here, then you can see there's white, and then there's actually a little bit outside that. Mm-hmm. Turns out the yarn in these is knittable. Huh. I went and I checked. So here we go. You're gonna see a lot of these. The bags are easier just to. So this is literally what I do, is I end up taking apart the baseball. So
that's awesome. You know, so you're constructing things. Covers.
Well, I deconstruct the baseball.
Yeah.
And then I've ended up, you know, I've created these cool original designs where the idea is that I'm partnering with the Hall of Fame and we'll end up taking those and auctioning them off in support of the Hall of Fame. Because it's a museum, it's a 501c3. It's not like MLB supports it.
Yeah.
So I had already, you know, started doing that, and you know, baseballs are hard to get, so you know, sort of getting them in the kind of places that frankly it still happens.
Yeah.
But going into 2017, you know, I'd already started doing the knitting, and the home run search, you know, the back when we had home run searches in 2017, and that was like unusual. People were looking at explanations for that. You actually had the home run committee working on stuff, trying to, you know, find out what was causing it, because nobody knew it was the ball. People forget that. They, you know, they'll remember in retrospect, of course it's the ball, like it seems like it's out, but at the time it wasn't. You know, people were looking at, you know, some people thought the players might be juicing again, some people thought, okay, is it the bats? My favorite, which was a legit thing that the home run committee did test, and I think it's awesome, was climate change. That somehow, because the earth is getting warmer, the balls are able to travel farther.
Yeah.
But there, it turns out that there actually is historical precedent for changes to the ball, you know, affecting how it travels, and particularly changes to the inside. One of the things that I feel like does not get enough, or it should be getting more attention than it does, which is that the transition from the dead ball to the live ball era. There are a few things. I mean, this isn't the only one, but it was right after World War I. And as with a war, you know, the yarn that was being used inside the baseballs, you know, this stuff, was not as good quality as it could have been. And so after the war, they started using merino from Australia, which is better yarn. And the ball at the same time started flying more. And so there was this idea of, had the ball been intentionally juiced? Mm-hmm. And the commissioner at the time said, no, it's just this new yarn. And so therefore it's more lively off the bat. That's tended to be discounted. However, there is something to that. If you were to change the type of yarn inside the baseball, yeah, it is going to change probably the it's called the coefficient of restitution, essentially how it comes off the bat. And yeah, I mean, I guess I the idea that you could change the yarn inside and not have an effect. Major and minor league baseballs have different kinds of yarn. They perform differently, and it's not just the drag. You know, so there is something to the idea. Knowing about what the interior of a major league baseball looked like, I thought with the 2017 home run search, yeah, okay, I'll take a look and see if it's something about the construction of the ball itself. And as it turns out, the home run committee did come out with, you know, that it was the ball, that there was something different, and it was something about the drag specifically. So basically the ball wasn't slowing down as fast in the air. So that was what was allowing it to travel farther. About 3 days before that committee report came out, I found a single thing that was different. I'd looked at balls from before in 2014, which is like at that low point before we started getting the rise in home runs, mm-hmm. and then some from, you know, it's actually 2016, 2017. It turns out the supplies are the same. But it turns out that the thickness of the laces, here, laces, my cat is not noticing, she can. Yeah, so the thickness of the laces turns out to be thicker with the balls that traveled farther.
Wow.
And it was the only thing that was what's called a statistically significant difference, meaning like you could absolutely say this is, you know, it's really, really unlikely basically that these two happen to be the same.
Interesting.
But at the time, the home run committee said the ball is something about the ball is different. They couldn't find out what the difference was.
Right.
3 days before that report came out, it's like, yeah, you know, I found something. This is really cool. And of course, I hadn't known that was going to be important. I didn't even know, like, you know, it was just kind of, oh, gee, that's interesting. Like, yeah. I sort of found it by accident. I was looking at something else and I noticed that the way that the laces compared, that, you know, these don't look like they're the same. And I checked and it turns out that one was thinner.
Interesting. Is it just the weave of the laces?
No, it's physically the thickness. I mean, they're both what's called, anything that's thread or yarn has what's called a ply to it.
Okay.
Meaning that it's sort of individual strands wrapped around each other. So I've checked, there's still 5 ply. The thing that's interesting is that it's not, the difference itself is very, very small. I mean, it's consistent. Like, you know, it's like thread. I mean, it is thread. It's just very thick thread. So if you think of sewing thread, that doesn't like become thicker and thinner, but it's very thin to begin with. So the difference was 9%.
Wow.
Which means it went, and this is all very thin to begin with. So it's, it went from like 0.75 to 0.83 millimeters across.
Wow.
So I mean, it turns out that with the way that I looked at the thickness, I do not have my chopstick. Shoot. My favorite tool, I kid you not, it's a chopstick with ruler tape on it. And if you do something, and this is knitting and weaving, you do this a lot, you something called wraps per inch. So by wrapping the laces around, I could actually see how many times it wraps around. In this case, it did centimeters instead, but that was enough to tell that they were thicker. So it's a really simple way to do it. You know, like you could have done this long before any kind of computing stuff.
Yeah.
But it's just, I don't think it would have occurred to people to ask the question, or that it was actually an easy thing to measure.
Yeah.
If you had not had
your background knowledge in knitting, do you think you would have?
I don't think it would have occurred to me to ask the question.
Yeah.
Because, you know, and it's a discussion I've had with any number of people over the years that changing the yarn is a legitimate way to have changed the actual interior behavior, which in this case didn't turn out to be the case. For the 2020 and 2021 new baseballs, that absolutely was the case with the interior. But for this, it's still pulled on, you know, like it wouldn't have occurred to people. I mean, I think the home run committee would have found it eventually, but you know, it would have been years instead of weeks.
Right. Yeah.
Sort of thing.
They
wouldn't have used that technique. It would have been, you know, something like a CAT scan or LIDAR or something like that.
Which is crazy. I mean,
you run into this all the time though. It's like, you know, people, and it's one of the things I think is cool is, you know, having expertise from other kinds of things can make a real difference. And I love that, you know, so actually one friend who, you know, he's designed telescopes and he would pull on his sailing knowledge a lot because it turned out that was relevant.
That's crazy. So, Very interesting.
Never discount what you're good at, because it might come in handy, basically.
Yeah, that's pretty crazy.
No,
you're good. I think I was just kind of curious when you were explaining that about your methods, I guess, for that, and how you noticed it. Did anybody kind of in the scientific community or at all ever question that? Or, I mean,
you know what? If anything, I've been surprised at how little that's come up, at least in a direct way. One thing that is very important in science is what's called reproducibility. So every time that I have done this, I am trying to be really detailed, frankly, about how I do something. You know, to the point of, in fact, the article on the 2021 baseball that Bradford Davis put out in Insider last year, we literally got a player to reproduce what I was doing at home with the same kind of tools. And he did it and he got the results. That, to my knowledge, is the only time somebody has done that, even though I will put out, this is what you do, this is how you do it, because I want people to try.
Right.
I don't know. I mean, frankly, it takes a long time to do this. Mm-hmm. And you have to, there is a learning curve. So if you're just starting, it takes even longer. But I had expected early on for, you know, like when 2019 started, I was expecting to get scooped because it was like such an obvious thing to look. And it seemed like people assumed this was my turf or something, which I found odd. I mean, I wasn't complaining because it meant I got to get really cool results. But it's also been interesting when people have taken issue with things, which happens, it tends to be along other lines. You know, it will be based on this type of, you know, the way that I'm thinking about something with how changes should happen. What you're finding doesn't seem to be having an effect without looking and seeing if what I'm finding is valid. Okay. Like, I'm not questioning what they're talking about in terms of how their model is being developed, for instance, but it doesn't necessarily address someone, if someone wants to take issue, like all I've got are the data.
Right.
And all I have are, frankly, their hypotheses to that need to have stuff, you know, beyond me,
right,
for testing them. But to come back with, you know, that someone isn't sure about stuff, I'd love to have someone actually, you know, try to do the same thing and see what their results look like. Actually, that's not true. Barton Smith, he's like the seam shifted weight guy. He's really done some amazing work with the physical structure in terms of how that makes the ball behave in the air. And his work is the best with that. He's like really made the connection between the physical structure that I've done and then what people will talk about with, say, StatCast and how the drag works or how brake is and things like that. So the connection is being made, but it's only been in the last like year or two. So
yeah, which is really interesting.
Oh, I love it. I love it.
Yeah. Yeah. And I will say too, it seems like, you know, it has become sort of your turf to a certain extent. Do you feel like that was from the onset of, like you mentioned, that 2019 research you did, or?
Well, I mean, the 2017, the 2017, nobody else had done it to this extent. Rob Arthur did some interesting stuff where they did a CAT scan or CAT scans looking. And I think they may have found I think they did find differences in the interior construction of the pill. That's the little rubber thing we just saw. Hang on. They're all in here somewhere. That's what a pill looks like when it's not cut in half. It's literally just a little rubber ball. And in fact, before 2017, and we didn't have StatCast data, so we couldn't tell that drag had changed. But anytime before that, if people talked about the ball maybe being juiced, it ultimately meant someone cutting into a baseball, taking out this and doing a bounce test. Okay. That was almost always what it came down to. Which turns out is not really the best way to do it. Like, you know, for like a dozen baseballs.
Yeah.
And I can tell you, and certainly the people who look at the StatCast data can tell you, that individual things for that, it's not going to work. Like, baseballs are different enough in a lot of ways where you really can't, you need a lot of baseballs for kind of an aggregate to see, okay, the drag is higher or the drag is lower. It's not like any one baseball will do that. And it's not just because of the physical ball itself, because they will be, you know, the seam heights will vary. How round the ball is varies. They're not all perfectly spherical underneath those seams. But on top of that, like the orientation of the seams themselves makes a difference. You know, if you have a ball, I'm not gonna get the spin right, but if you have a ball coming at you, say with the seams like that, it's going to be very different than a ball coming at you with the seams like that. It's like literally just going to have different drag. It's going to move slightly differently in the air. So, you know, you could take, I'd love to see someone try this, you know, I'm speculating here. You could take the same baseball and hit it, or, you know, put it in like a hack attack or something 10 different times. And same launch angle, same exit velocity, it would probably travel 10 different distances.
That's insane.
Because it's going to get knocked around. So it's going to become less round. Mm-hmm. And it's going to have a different seam orientation when it gets hit and when it travels. That's so it's just, I mean, that's partly why baseball is cool, is because that seam, you know, that's why seam shifted wake is seam shifted wake. You spin it in a particular way so that the seams are doing something very particular and the ball behaves in that way.
That's awesome.
You know, no other sport is like, you know, we made this complicated. And it's fun because it's complicated. Yeah.
There's variability all over.
Oh yeah. Well, it's actually, frankly, it's what I would call a semi-chaotic system. Like when you hear about chaos, that's just the physics here has chaos built in. So
that is pretty cool. Yeah. Yeah, that is really cool.
Yeah. So anybody who thinks that baseball is just a game, or that we can't not mention that the game's being shut down, but I want to say it was Ross Stripling had some kind of comment about like, what did they think were dumb jocks?
Yeah.
They're not. I know a lot of really smart baseball players. I mean, they're not all, but I know some really smart baseball players, you know? So it's an intellectual game.
Yeah. Well, and to have, I mean, honestly, you spoke about having a player repeat, you know, your process of looking at balls. And I mean, it's not like, even though maybe to you it's easy, like that's not always easy. So that was impressive to me that I noted that when you said that. I was like, that's actually pretty cool. Like,
yeah.
So I did want to talk about kind of your 2019 and 2020 work and moving forward.
Oh, it gets, I mean, yeah, we can go through it's, I mean, 2017, what I ended up discovering was that thicker lace stuff. In fact, here's another knitting crossover. So the laces are cotton. The actual yarn inside the ball is wool, which behaves in one way. And in fact, that ends up coming back to the new ball they designed for 2020. The interior being wool turns out to be important. The laces being cotton turn out to be important for 2017 in that wet cotton, when it stretches, if you let it air dry, it will stay stretched. So a way to think about it is if you've ever spilled coffee on a t-shirt, and then you go into the bathroom and you try to scrub it out, and there's a divot in your shirt for the rest of the day.
Yeah.
Because it air dried. On the other hand, you wash it and you put it in the dryer and it shrinks back to normal because it's being, you know, there's the heat and the agitation and stuff. So baseballs historically have been air dried. And so what that means is that if you have thicker laces, they just don't stretch as much as thinner. You know, like you put the same amount of tension on them. So having a ball that's got thicker laces, it means this is like the weak point. Mm-hmm. So the ball, if it's going to deform from being totally round, it's going to be along the seams.
Okay.
So the thinner the laces are, the more you're going to get almost like this, you know, making the ball, it's almost like you'd end up with something square. It's logical conclusion, I guess. But thinner laces, you end up with a ball that's less round, hence it's traveling. It's not traveling as far. So thicker laces turn out to actually make the ball have lower drag, which is totally counterintuitive because people tend to think that lace thickness and seam height are the same thing, and they're not.
Yeah, that's a lot of detail.
Right. Well, but again, and that's where the physics comes in and knowing what cotton does.
Right.
That's another one, you know, like, so, and that, by the way, turned out So it wasn't just finding that the difference for 2017, but finding, and frankly, that's what I think has happened. There may be another explanation for it, but I haven't heard anybody postulate one. So, you know, I'm all for other hypotheses. Yes, please. You know, I want to hear them. But yeah, 2019 turned out to be almost the converse of that, which is that the leather was very smooth. The laces were, the seams were very flat. The balls were very round. It turns out that is a lot easier to produce even than I realized when I did the research. Take any baseball, if you soak the surface of it and throw it in the dryer, probably with a bunch of towels because it'll make a lot of noise otherwise and you won't be able to get anything done. Throw it in the dryer for, I don't know, 15 to 45 minutes. I did this unrelated to something. I basically got a bunch of baseballs that were like soaking wet, and I needed to find a way to sort of dry them. I couldn't do a ton because I needed the actual data, but they came out of the dryer and I had a ball that was perfectly round with flat seams and very slick leather, which if you think about it, if you bounce a baseball around in a dryer, like, so it's getting hit randomly.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the most likely thing is it's going to end up being hit enough on all the sides that it'll end up round. Those seams will get flat and the leather gets slicked down. So it looks like they literally threw 2019 baseballs in the dryer, and that's how they got them.
Is that just the way they were created, just that differently?
I think, otherwise they seem basically the same. The laces are thinner, And I think that might have been intentional, because there were reports of blisters that players were, pitcher okay. blisters were a problem. It might have just been that the supplier changed, that it didn't have to be that, but it would have been consistent with the blister problem and people realizing that thinner laces would have made that not happen as much. But as far as I can tell, the reason that they went from air drying, or I shouldn't say the reason, one logical reason for them to have gone from air drying to throwing them in the dryer was 2019 was also the first year that they started using the Major League Baseball in AAA. And so that's like, they made an extra, normally there's like 1.2 million that are made for Major League Baseball. They now make 1.8 million. Wow. So like there's 50% more that are made for AAA. If you suddenly have to make 50% more baseballs, and they did like expand everything, they have the capacity, but it takes about a week for a baseball to dry. So if you air dry it. So the idea of wanting to speed that up when you have so many more that are being produced makes sense.
Yeah.
So if you throw it in the dryer, they should dry more quickly. It's just that they also ended up with a very, very slick, round baseball with flat seams.
Yeah. Wow. So that combination.
Also, yeah. Well, yeah. It's also possible that I mean, that strikes me as the sort of one logical reason for doing it. The way manufacturing is done, even with the air drying, though, Rawlings makes an effort to make the ball rounder and flatten the seams. Like part of the process they have after the balls are finished is they essentially put them in this sort of a chute where they end up getting rolled around specifically to flatten the seams and make the keep the balls rounder. So putting them in a dryer, you end up with a lot flatter seams and a much rounder ball, which seems to have been a goal for a while. And this would have been after the home run committee put in recommendations for making tolerances, more stringent. So like basically they didn't like the fact that they're, that there seemed to be so much variation. And so that might have been a way that was being considered for minimizing variation. I mean, yeah. It's, and again, Rawlings has not told me about this stuff. It's not something I can get answers on, they have all this information. It's just not something that they ever make public, but that ended up, being the 2019 home run search. So we've got a 2017 home run search, 2019 home run search. Then they changed the ball. Well, I shouldn't say changed. They introduced a different ball in the 2019 postseason. And so that was that turns out to have been a mix of two baseballs, which we ran into again. And I did not expect that. But for the 2019 postseason, it really just turned out, it really looks like they ran out of 2019 baseballs. And interestingly enough, the ones that I was able to, that I did find that were this different kind that had, they were consistent with balls that were before 2019 with the, much higher drag and not like these super round, slick, flat lace ball or flat seam balls. They turned out actually to be 2020s, which I did not realize until I had cracked the batch codes for, 2020. But I sort of picture them as like teleporting from the future, because they were made before the 2019 postseason, but they're mm-hmm. part of the balls that were used for 2020. Like they were always intended for that.
Yeah.
And you did see them in the 2020 regular season. Like I saw balls that were made during those same weeks.
No, you're good.
But yeah, I feel like it's almost like, I'm knocking things down. It's like 2017, got it. 2019 home run search, got it. 2019 postseason, got it. 2022 baseballs, got that. 2021, two baseballs again, got that. I'm waiting. We'll see what happens this season. It's crazy.
Yeah. And I mean, it is crazy. Would you be able to speak sort of about, do you have any theories on, it sounds like a lot of it is just process oriented. Mm-hmm. Do you think it is purposeful?
Well, actually for 2020, in 2020, it did start being purposeful. And there are, the explanations have been interesting because there were two kinds of baseballs made. And actually to give, I want to give context for this, because a big reason that the that I was able to sort of definitively say there were two kinds of baseballs before MLB acknowledged it were that I did, I was able to crack what we call the batch codes, which is just, they're just inventory codes. So if you can read that.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Get a BB, B, SLC, something.
Yep, that's it. BBB, SLC, actually.
That's on the.
No, SLCE, sorry. There's an E at the end there.
That's on the inside?
It's on the inside. Yeah, so it's on the inside of the cover.
Okay.
You know, right there. And it can be either one. This is literally just an inventory code that Rawlings uses. And it turns out that it's just a numeric code that translates to the word black horse.
Oh,
like they literally use the word that it's like already a known thing with people who do collection or collector stuff, because they use that on the outside of baseball gloves. And that's, it's, I felt really silly that I didn't discover it a lot sooner. Like I actually went through and derived it myself. And then someone said, yeah, you know, this is out here.
Oh, well.
Right. So once I, you know, realized that that was what was going on and plugged in, you know, I was going to say, you can write this down if you want. Do you want to translate what the numbers are?
Yeah, sure.
Better way to do it.
You said it's.
So it says BBB.
SLCE. E.
So Black Horse, it's 1 through 0 with, you know, BLACKHORS. So you can translate that to a number, 7 digits.
No idea.
Okay, so B is 1. So there's 1, 1, 1. See that?
Yeah.
Okay, the and then S is 9. So it's 1, 1, 1, 9.
I can
L
see
L is 2.
Okay.
C is 4. And E is 0.
Interesting. Yeah, it does now. Is that... I've never heard of that black horse.
Nobody had really looked at it. And, you know, but, and honestly, like once you sort of know what the code is, it's not hard at all.
But no,
if you don't, it looks kind of like,
I know. I was like, how?
Right.
Yeah.
It turns out when you look at that, so it's 11/19. That's just a date or a month. Okay. So that's literally November, 2019. Then the 240 at the end is what I would call a production week.
Okay.
And so that corresponds, I don't have it in front of me. That's like September, I think, it's November, November 2019. So there are, you know, 240, 241.
Okay.
In that like list of production weeks, and they do go in order. So like when you go to December, it would be like, you know, 244, and it'll keep going into January, and you get like a 248 in there or something. So it's literally each week, you know, roughly you can see gaps, which in fact turn out to, they look like they're meaningful, frankly, like you can see where, say, they're changing production between from year to year. But what was interesting was once I cracked those, what I discovered was that there was a transition in September of 2019. Balls were made for a few months for the 2020 season. You know, it was like, I want to say July through September were 2020 balls. So they started making them. Actually, it might've even been earlier. And then, what ended up happening was they then switched on a hard switch from making one kind of baseball to making a completely different kind.
Wow.
And I could actually tell that there was a difference. It again, if you sort of take them apart, and a lot of the questions are a lot easier once you explain something to answer. I mean, some of the stuff with like the lace thickness is more complicated, but this is what's inside the leather covers. They call it the center. And this is like everything you just saw inside.
Mm-hmm.
Everything inside the covers is that.
Okay.
So it's the 3 layers of yarn and the pill.
Okay. And I probably most people, if they listen to this, they're going to, you know, it looks, they probably seen an inside of a baseball, but
that's why I'm showing the pictures.
Yeah. Yeah. So just in case they don't watch the video.
Okay. So inside the ball, there is the rubber pill, which is just the core, and that's rubber. And then there's two layers of cork on the inside. And then there's three layers of yarn, which it's mostly wool. There's some polyester in it too. And there's the thickest kind of yarn is on the inside, and it's gray, and most of the ball is that. Then there is a thin layer of white yarn that's sort of a middle thickness. And then the outer layer is gray again. That's the thinnest yarn of the three. Outside of that, there is a layer of what's basically cotton sewing thread. And that's okay. Just mostly to make the ball sort of, if you've seen a ball of yarn, there's little, you know, the yarn is thick. So by taking the sewing thread, you can then make it rounder, you know, so the bulges aren't there as much. And then on top of that, they'll actually take the leather covers and they soak the covers, which is why the drying process is important, because in order to get the cover to become round, it's a flat cover, you got to find a way to stretch it across the baseball. So they soak the covers, then they'll stretch them across, and there's glue so that, you know, for people watching, you can tell it's sticking, right?
Yeah.
You know, and then with the wet covers and the glue on the ball, mm-hmm. they can then stitch the balls by hand, and they are stitched by hand.
Okay.
The part inside the covers is the winding process is on the machine. They have winding machines, which is frankly how they can make them, you know, fit the rules, because you can't have it all by hand. Gets a little much.
I was going to ask have you looked at that at all, or the variability of stitching?
The stitching is interesting, because the question that gets brought up a lot is how come the stitching is done by hand? And there really doesn't appear to be a way to stitch baseballs using a machine in a way that's like, you know, that actually is economically viable.
Wow.
I don't know if there are patents out there, but if you've watched, there are great videos where you'll actually see, it almost looks like someone's swimming a butterfly is what I always think of, where they'll have like, you know, they'll have two hands and pull the stitches out at the same time. And it's hard to stitch a baseball, even for a person, and being able to do it with a machine. So every single baseball in the world, down to like Little League or souvenir or whatever, is stitched together by hand.
That's awesome.
All of them, which I don't think, and it's the only sports thing in the world that's like that. Even cricket, which would be the next, their balls only at the very highest levels are stitched by hand. Otherwise there are machines that do it, but every baseball.
Yeah, that's super interesting. Just another variable too, to kind of.
Well, and that's another reason why, you know, trying to standardize too much is difficult, because you do have human beings.
Right.
And so it's not like you're putting something into an injection mold.
Right.
The pill is an injection mold, but that's it.
Yeah. So everything around that, and I know you mentioned the threads around it.
That's done on a winding machine.
Okay. But that's, still that's, it. Mm-hmm. It has human attached.
Well, there is a human being. And in that case, you've got a human being setting it up for winding. And afterwards, they do check the weight. You know, like they'll actually double check, because the way that it works is each layer weighs a given amount.
Okay.
You know, and once there's actually a weight trip on the winding machine, so that when that particular layer gets to the right weight, the thing shuts off.
Okay.
And so, and then you'll actually have a human being check to make sure it's the right weight, put it on the next one, same process. So the human being is there both to set it up and to make sure that it's fitting the manufacturing specifications. But that also means that the balls, once you get inside the covers, are very standardized.
Okay.
The covers can vary a lot in terms of like thickness and how pliable they are and how heavy they are as a result. You'd be surprised how much the variability goes away as soon as you take the covers off.
Yeah.
Which is really interesting.
Baseballs are like snowflakes.
snowflakes. In fact, that's not a bad analogy. But yeah, it turns out that with the 2020 ball, so they had, you know, a few months of what was basically normal centers, you know, and the weights were what I'd seen going back like 20 years. And then starting in September of 2019, they started being a totally different weight. And it wasn't outrageous. It was a difference of about 2.5 grams.
Wow.
Which is just under a quarter, no point. I think it's a tenth of an ounce, just under a tenth of an ounce. But it was insanely consistent across the board. Like it was, there was no question it was different. Right. And once I started looking at the individual layers, what I discovered was that very inner layer that I mentioned, the one that's the has the most yarn, was actually 3.5 grams lighter. Hmm. And then the outer layer was a gram heavier.
Interesting.
And across the board, it was like this for this new kind of baseball, which didn't seem to have any precedent.
Right.
They made that one for 4 months and then they stopped. And then they went back to making the one that they'd made before for like 20 years, at least.
Interesting.
So this was 2020 production. And I did find, I didn't have a lot of base. I had a lot of baseballs for me because, you know, having a couple dozen for a season was great. In this case, I had like, you know, 40 something. For me, that was a huge number, but I had two kinds of baseballs showing up. And once I realized that it wasn't just two kinds, but they were made at physically different times where the entire factory had clearly shifted over and shifted back. It was really weird to then go to MLB and say, you know, by the way, we're finding these two completely different kinds of baseballs. What's up? You know, Steph Apstein wrote an article on this for Sports Illustrated that came out in February of 2020. And, February of 2021. Your years are running together, mine are. But and when she approached MLB and said, you know, Meredith has found this stuff, we weren't sure what they were going to say. We weren't sure if they were going to get back to her. And not only did they get back to her, they said, oh yeah, you know, first of all, they said these shouldn't have appeared in games, even though they did.
Yeah.
Where have we heard that story before? Or after, I should say. But they also said, oh no, we did this on purpose. Yes, this is a real different ball. We specifically made a different kind of ball because it's, and the way it was designed, and this makes sense because it's a way that it will still fit into the rules requirements, was they took that inner layer and even though it was lighter, they wound it more loosely. Mm-hmm. So it was still as big. And so like it was still the same size, but it was just, it ended up by having less interior, essentially it becomes less dense as a way.
Right.
Wow. The idea for that was to actually make it come off the bat, not as hard.
It's okay.
The technical term is the coefficient of restitution, but it literally ends up, it's like the ball squishes more against the bat when it hits, which deadens it when it comes off. So it's quite literally how you deaden a baseball.
Okay.
And the idea was to lower the exit velocity. And then hence, if you have fewer home runs. And that was, they said, we did this on purpose because we wanted to deaden the ball to decrease the number of home runs. We made a completely different baseball that was specifically intended to do completely different things on the field.
Interesting and crazy.
At the time they said, you know, these weren't supposed to be in games. We're saving them all for 2021. What's interesting is that they also accounted for 4 months of production, and production is a year long thing, but that still means it was 4 out of 12 months.
Right.
So it would have been a third of production, which is kind of hard to say, oh no, we were going to save all of these for the next season, because I'm not really sure. I mean, we had a COVID shortened season. So if they wanted to, they could have only used one baseball, but if it had been a normal length season, I'm not sure they could have just used 2/3 of the baseballs. They ran out the previous year, remember?
Yeah.
It's kind of hard. But, you know, they said, okay, no, we're saving these for 2021. And then before Steph's article came out, but, you know, after we talked to them, they sent a memo to GMs, an internal memo directly to GMs. And Ken Rosenthal and Eno Saris published about this. And Steph's article came out very quickly after that. Like we hadn't intended for it to be quite as quickly, but you know,
the memo just came out.
Yeah. And the thing that was interesting is what they said in the memo was exactly what they told Steph a couple days before they sent the memo. The wording was the same.
Right.
Make of that what you will. But you know, when they said, oh yeah, here's the ball that's going to be used in 2021. And we were saving them for you, but this is the ball you're going to see in 2021. So everybody knew, like, there were articles out there, great, we're going to have this deadened ball, things are going to change. They used both kinds of baseballs in 2021. A bunch of them were left over because we had a shortened season. So like the first half of the season was basically baseballs from leftover 2020s. However, we had 2021s and they made both kinds for 2021 also, you know, including some that were made after that memo went out, after they told teams, we're going to use this new kind of baseball in 2021. They had gone back to making the old kind of baseball for months after they sent that memo out. So I don't know if anything in the memo they told teams, you know, there was a new baseball, but it wasn't the only one. And they hadn't made only that new one for 2021.
Yeah.
And there didn't seem to have been any intention to even switch over after they told teams. It's not like it went, oops, you know, we got caught and therefore we should just make the one that we're going to tell teams going into the future. No, they were already making the old one and they kept making it. And yeah, so I'm not, and it did, I think it really did affect things.
Well, that's what I was going to ask, you know, if you're able to speak to the repercussions of that, either that you have seen actualized or that maybe we can't see yet, anything like that.
There's some things that have shown up, although it's been complicated because, I guess there's a couple of things. First, there was a really good article about 2021 spring training that Rob Arthur and Ben Lindbergh put out, where they found really, really clear evidence of balls with two different exit velocities and two different drags appearing in spring training in a way that actually seemed to change over time. Like, you know, the balls that were being given to teams at the beginning were different than the balls that were being given to them at the end. And what they found was that there were rather than exit velocities going down with what was presumably this new kind of baseball, those baseballs had exit velocities that went up, which was the opposite of what MLB had said. The thing is, and this is where the knitting and the yarn stuff comes back. If you have, because the yarn is wool, does your hair frizz when it gets humid?
Yep.
Okay. So, right. So think of it as your hair, like, you know, when they tested these baseballs, they only tested them in a lab. Temperature was the same. Humidity was the same. There was no outdoor testing. It was very controlled.
Okay.
There was nothing about drag done at all. And they didn't test anything outside the lab. So there was nothing about real life conditions. The problem is that you know, the humidity was reasonable in the lab, and wool is gonna, when it's humid, is gonna do like what your hair does with frizzing. The problem is that when that humidity goes away, it's like with your hair, it's suddenly gonna get flatter. So suddenly the yarn for wool would have done the same kind of thing, but those covers are on really, really tight. So what it looks like is it looks like the covers just went down onto the ball when the humidity went down. So suddenly it being less dense and therefore squishing more against the bat was no longer the case because, you know, the yarn was no longer frizzing, as it were.
Right.
The problem is that, first of all, you know, it looks like it might've gone back to about the same as it was before, except, you know, first of all, the actual layers might've had something to do with it, but also the ball was lighter. And it turns out that that's part of it also for the exit velocity. It's not just that it squishes more, but if it's lighter, you can just make it, you know, it's conservation of momentum. And so a lighter ball is just easier to hit hard off the bat. So it's between the two, having the lower humidity, it's consistent with what we saw, having the less dense ball, it's suddenly no longer, it's lighter, therefore it's gonna have higher exit velocities. On top of that though, this, and this is like, I have actually looked at changing humidity I've mentioned this before we came on the air, but I've figured out, I've made two DIY humidors so that I could like vary the humidity and you know, see what the effects are. But what it looks like is that once you're pulling the humidity out, the seams are staying high basically, but the between the seams is going down.
Yeah.
So higher seams, they were also finding the balls with higher exit velocity had higher drag. They were slowing down more in the air. And the result that they found was that the higher drag does mean it shouldn't travel as far. However, the exit velocities were up enough where they were actually getting stuff coming up just above 2017. So the ball didn't apply farther. But so I guess where I'm going with that is that under those conditions, the ball behaved in a way that you could tell. The problem is the spring training, it's either Florida or Arizona, and it's a very controlled setting. On the other hand, when you get into the season, it's 6 months in a lot of different areas of the country, and some parks have humidors and mm-hmm. some don't. And so what it looks like you ended up with was just that new ball was behaving very differently at different times of the year and in different places. So ironically, their goal of a more consistent baseball, their new baseball was the least consistent probably.
Oh, best laid plans.
So that's kind of, you know, I think where the main issues have come in with that new ball. That being said, there was some interesting stuff done with DJ LeMahieu's numbers. Mm-hmm. The type of deadening to the ball that they had, he's always been a laser home run hitter. You know, so like they're only going to clear the fence by a bit. If you deaden the ball the way that they've talked about, those should turn into long doubles or outs or something. So his home run numbers really did suffer in 2021.
It's interesting you bring that up because I involved with fantasy baseball and all of the draft commentary around him is about numbers like that from last year. So even seeing it, you know, outside of his own livelihood, that kind of thing is interesting.
Well, in that case, I'm curious about, this is where it would come back to, I'd love it if we knew how Rawlings had distributed the baseballs, because, you know, first of all, we've got those batch codes. So, you know, we know when the baseballs were made. MLB has specifically said these two kinds of baseballs were designed to perform differently. So we know that there were two kinds being used that are actually, it's not a mistake. They're intentionally supposed to perform differently. But what they also said after the 2019 postseason, when the Home Run Committee did their 2019 report, was one of their recommendations was, you know, using something like the batch codes to track baseballs from start to finish. So like, you know, not just knowing what was coming up from the factory in Costa Rica, but making sure that they knew which baseballs that were manufactured at a given time were ending up at which parks at what time. I mean, even to the, I checked this recently, even to the point of having somebody at the stadium record which balls were being used in which games. Like this was their recommendation. MLB, I don't remember if it was, I don't think it was Morgan Sword. Someone in the commissioner's office said, you know, we're going to adopt these recommendations.
Okay.
So they're on the record at the end of 2019 saying, yeah, we're going to track these start to finish. So I'm not really, they should know where all the balls have gone and which have gone to which places. But even if it was like, you know, part of the old and part new at Yankee Stadium, and I didn't have enough Yankees baseballs to be able to tell that. Even if some, you know, say half of them, say it was a half and half, that would have been enough of those new balls. So let's say we take half of DJ LeMahieu's numbers and half of them are normal. And the other half are this deader ball. Hence the home runs just in that half are fewer. He's still going to end up with fewer home runs. You know, you'd still have, as long as it's enough, it still has an effect. So I think people haven't really thought about that it's not like you have to have all of one kind and all of another. The effect would probably be the most dramatic, but you just need enough. And so it's going to have an impact that they exist at all, particularly because you can't tell them apart on the outside. That's actually the thing that's the most disturbing.
You know? Yeah. That is
what I was talking about with the leather covers, and there being a lot of variants there. If you pick two of them up, unless it's like really on the heavy side or really on the light side, I got a lot of them wrong, like guessing, opening them up. It was kind of annoying after a while, but you know, and I don't think I talked to a single player who had thought anything, you know. I love that Pete Alonso was basically right.
Yeah. You know, it was such a big deal, you know, when he said that.
It's a little, you know, that level of conspiracy insidious. I mean, you know, it's really hard to to be like, okay, we're gonna submarine a particular year because of these type of free agents. And that's a little too convoluted. But yeah, you know, the impact is a real thing, and MLB knows where the balls are going.
Yeah.
So, you know, that whole, we know where baseballs are going and we know what they are, is there. But it was, when I talked to players, not a single one of them realized they were in a given game. I have one situation where somebody gave me actual pitches in the game. Mm-hmm. This is the at bat. I've got balls like from the same at bat that are different.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Absolutely crazy.
The umpires didn't know, obviously. They wouldn't.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of interesting to think about that. People will talk about, oh yeah, you know, what if an umpire was throwing this kind of ball out when this guy was up at bat? That would require the umpires knew.
Yeah, right.
Nobody,
which is another.
Yeah. Knew, you know?
Yeah.
It's insane.
Yeah. I don't know if you are able to speak to this, and I know, you know, mainly you want to focus on the scientific aspect of it, but you know, if what you're seeing is the MLB knew, do you have any thoughts about like motive behind it, or do you think it was just purely accidental, or
well, here's the thing, they made two different kinds of baseballs 2 years in a row. I mean, I have data starting just for this switch back and forth. It starts in, I want to say June or July of 2019. I think it's July. And from summer of 2019 through the summer of 2021. So it's like, say, July 2019 through August of 2021, which turns out to be like two production cycles. They made two different kinds of baseballs for more than 2 years. And with hard switches back and forth. So there, it's not an accident. It's
right.
Not a mistake. I'm not, you know, the idea of distribution somehow being, you know, mistake or not, there had to be knowledge of it.
Right.
I have no idea. I mean, and that's actually one of the things that's been weird. I have no idea as to the why for the two baseballs. I could see them if they legitimately switched over to a single one, to you know, to deaden the ball and change home runs. But we have 2 years in a row where they couldn't have not used two baseballs.
Right.
It's not like you had such a small thing that you might have actually considered them as only being for, you know, for showcase or demonstration or exhibition or whatever. You had to have two. What's weird is that every other time I've found a change or a difference or whatever, there's been some logical explanation I can come up with, like the lace thickness thing. It turns out if you go back historically, you know, I've actually started looking back into like the early 90s, late 80s, lace thickness does change, you know, in year to year, over sets of years. And it's just, it seems to have to do with like where they're buying the laces from.
Yeah.
Because when you talk about that, you know, tiny fraction of a millimeter, no one's going to be able to tell really, or at least they're not, even if they can, it's not going to occur to them that having a 0.08 millimeter thickness difference is going to make any difference, right?
Right.
You know, it seems too small. So, you know, okay, so they get a different supplier, cost them less money. When I mentioned about the 2019 balls and being slicker and having flatter seams, speeding up the drying process. It's a good reason for that. For the 2019 postseason, they ran out of 2019 baseballs. They had to get them from somewhere or you couldn't have played the postseason.
Right.
So like there's been a good explanation for even the weirdest things that seem to have happened until this 2020 manufacturing cycle. I have no idea as to the why. There had to be a why. The other thing that comes to mind is, let's say there's some nefarious reason. Mm-hmm. This ball, this new kind of baseball was specifically designed to be dead. Mm-hmm. They've made that very clear all along. The problem is that it's not consistently dead. When it's really dry, it's actually juiced compared to the normal ball. So let's say we've got, the twisty mustache nefarious plants. They wouldn't be working anyway because the ball isn't behaving the way that they had intended it to. So, we foiled their plans, or they foiled their own plans. And I keep picturing the Scooby-Doo villain every time.
It does sound pretty funny.
Forgive me for doing this, but once you have a Scooby-Doo villain image in your head and you look at Rob Manfred, it just, once you see it, you kind of can't.
He's been unmasked.
but I mean, can't you say, and I would have gotten away with it if it weren't for you meddling kids. Sorry, it's stuck in my head. It's terrible, but yeah. So I guess to your question, it had to be done for some reason.
Right.
I cannot think of a good one. And frankly, if there was a not good one, I can't figure out what that would be either, other than that it probably didn't do what they would have had it been there.
Yeah.
So, if that makes sense.
Yeah. And I mean, it's crazy, all the different variables. And this is something, I don't know if you can speak to it at all. But I think one thing as a fan, just watching, obviously we didn't know about juice balls or dead balls at the time, but the sticky substances ban thrown in there.
That makes me angry.
It's a little wild.
Yeah, I can think of reasons why it would have been done that didn't have directly to do with performance. And I am going to leave to other people, but I was extremely frustrated when that came out, not just because they did it, but because the time period that they looked at for here is where we're seeing, they claimed was entirely effective sticky stuff, was only April, 2021. Where they had already said, we're specific, this is at the time, I knew they were using two kinds of baseballs. Other people, I felt like somebody should have questioned, by the way, you specifically said you're using this different kind of ball. You had these results from Ben Lindbergh and Rob Arthur showing whatever this new kind of ball was actually doing some really weird stuff. Mm-hmm. And yet you said the only change has been players using sticky stuff, because that's the only part you picked had this different kind of baseball. How the heck can you say that it's the sticky stuff,
right,
when you're talking about a different kind of baseball?
Right. Yeah, exactly.
It was, I mean, to use a scientific term, it's what's referred to as an ill-posed problem. You cannot separate those things out. So therefore, whatever answer you're going to get won't make sense. So they couldn't have even asked the question legitimately.
Right. Yeah. And I think that's something in hindsight that, I mean, the sticky stuff commentary, it dropped off a little towards the end of the season.
Let's put it this way. I will leave it to you for a time where I'm not on to think about what happened when they imposed the sticky stuff ban, what completely horrible story hit the press about a week later concerning a particular Cy Young winner, and when the sticky stuff dropped off, but nobody talked about it.
Thank you. Just some food for thought.
A Cy Young winner who was very adamant about what sticky stuff did.
Yeah. Yeah.
And
interesting. Interesting. Yes. And I think, all of this conversation.
That's hypothesis, by the way.
Yeah. All of this in combination with everything else that's been going on, CBA and everything lately, is very, what is this game we're watching anymore, and how it's going to develop?
I have no idea. One thing for this upcoming season, because they used so many leftover 2020s, they have a lot of leftover 2021s. You know, and one thing I will say about the statement that MLB put out related to the 2021 study for Bradford's article, the explanation that they gave was that it was a supply chain issue. And they made it sound like we only used leftover 2020s. We couldn't have, there wouldn't have been enough. But that there was, because of COVID, you know, there had been manufacturing. There was manufacturing that went down for like a couple months. And then it came back almost to full strength for the rest of the time. But this, there was a supply chain thing in that balls that were made after about October of 2020 didn't actually start showing up until after the All-Star break. Normally that's, you have kind of, we've heard this like with 2015, where after the All-Star break, that was when people started seeing home runs go up in a way that said the ball was somehow like different. Mm-hmm. There really are sort of two major distribution like periods. I haven't had this confirmed, but it would be consistent with having half of the stock shipped up before the season from Costa Rica, you know, comes in on a barge to St. Louis, second half shipped up for July. In July, I suddenly started seeing balls that were made after October of 2020. Normally that stuff would have been mixed in a little more, but it wasn't. Okay. So I have to wonder if they didn't, you know, that in that case there was a supply chain issue, like the stuff was, because they were made on the same timetable. They just didn't end up in games. So I do think that the barge that had all that stuff on it somehow couldn't get stuff up or something.
Okay. Yeah.
So we were missing baseballs that should have otherwise been here, but they made it eventually.
Yeah.
They just made it in for July.
A little delayed.
Right. So, but that also means that for the first half, we almost saw only 2020s. So if you have 3 months where we know they're leftover baseballs almost entirely, and the 2021s only show up in the second half, that says to me that they probably have maybe half of their stock of 2021s still sitting in inventory in Missouri. So I don't know how they're going to just, maybe they'll leave them sitting there, but they used leftovers last season, and I can't see them like having hundreds of thousands of baseballs just leaving them there or doing something else with them.
Right.
That's a lot of baseballs.
I think I had somebody pose the question like, well, don't they use them for giveaways or exhibition games?
Hundreds of thousands?
Right. Yeah.
It's too many. Yeah.
That's a lot.
I mean, yeah, it just, there's, I don't know. I can't, they might not, but I have a feeling that we will see a lot of leftover 2021s. In 2022, which means that, you know, two baseballs is going to happen again. Seriously. I mean, so just, you know, regardless of what MLB said, although frankly, all they really said in their statement was they weren't going to keep using any 2020s. When you look at like the dates they're referring to, pretty sure they're not, because they probably did use all those up.
But then we might see rollover this year.
Yeah, so, and it would just be, it's not something that's happened in the past, because normally the baseballs aren't there, but this is a lot. So,
well, yeah. And then, you know, with the season already having games canceled and potentially being more truncated, you know, that it seems like it might create.
We're going to end up really off at this rate, aren't we? I mean, we're already like a half a season off. So, yeah.
Nope. Just a domino.
I mean, one thing also, I guess people need to be aware of is, all but a few of the 2022s do already exist. So it's not like they can suddenly start doing, you know, there are some that are going to be made for a few months, but the turnover is in the middle of the summer, you know, July, August. Last year it was August. And it was, you know, so they've been making 2022s since what looks like the end of August, beginning of September.
Okay.
And, you know, I'd assume they're still making them. You know, I don't think they would take the time off. But yeah, so most of them are already made for people who are like, yeah, oh, well, maybe they can just start juicing. I mean, they could, but it would still only be a fraction of them.
Right.
And it's not like they can suddenly turn them around. You know, they need to come up on that barge from Costa Rica.
Yeah. You know, just poof. That's super interesting. So you know, I guess as your work kind of continues with this, do do you have any next things you're going to look at that you can share, or alternatively?
I'm waiting to learn about the 2022s. Mm-hmm. It's going to be, I'm curious to see if they use the leftovers. I think mm-hmm. they will, but you know, I need to confirm that. The other thing is that for the two previous manufacturing calendars for 2020 and 2021, they made baseballs for the first of the old kind for like the first 2.5-ish months, and mm-hmm. then switched to the new. With the calendar switchover from 2021 to 2022, and I've actually found, sort of what it looks like a final, sort of cutoff time, which would have been like the third week in August. But Rawlings also told The Athletic in July that they were going to be transitioning to 2022 in July or August.
Okay.
So what I found is consistent with what Rawlings said. The thing is, the article that Bradford wrote didn't come out till November 30th, which is more than 2 months from the end of August. So if they followed the same manufacturing calendar a third year in a row, and they were the same for 2020 and 2021, so I'm not sure we can pretend it's a fluke, they would have switched over between two kinds of baseballs for 2022. So I'm waiting to see if that happened at all. I mean, maybe they caught it after the article came out. I don't know. Maybe it never happened. It'll be interesting to see, though. Find it. All, not to mention the fact that I'm not sure MLB said, because they didn't really say, if the takeaway, I think, from their statement in November was, we're not going to have two baseballs anymore. There's going to be one going forward. It was the takeaway. Mm-hmm. If you actually take it apart, they don't, it's not what they say. But they didn't say which kind.
Right. Okay.
So I'm not really sure what to expect there either.
But that's something we can expect maybe.
Yeah. But the problem is that as long as they keep doing this, it means I have to do the following season.
Right.
So it'll be 2023 before I could possibly have a break.
Right.
And that would only be if nothing was weird about 2022, which I don't expect. So it might be more like 2024 before I get a break.
Yeah. You're going to be busy for a while.
Yeah. I look forward to like having a lot of baseballs and being like, oh, darn, I have nothing left to do. I just get to go to baseball games and enjoy them. I
don't have to worry about this anymore.
I have so many hundreds of baseballs by now. My God.
Yeah. How many do you think you have?
I was trying to work. I want to say it's like between 750 and 1,000.
That's insane. That's a lot.
Or is that just the ones I have here in California?
I know. I remembered we talked about this a little bit.
Yeah. It's either that many or twice that many. I forget which, because I think it's like I've half here in California and half in Wisconsin. And so I've had this question asked so many times now. I need to just like have that number at my fingertips.
Estimate's but fine. That's pretty crazy.
It is. And I mean, I'm super careful about storing them and cataloging them. So I try to keep a lot of track so that I know which balls are being used. If I'm lucky, I have it down to the pitch.
Right.
But I have to have people who are really paying attention to do that. So.
Yeah. Yeah. And I know you mentioned a bandsaw somewhere in your process.
Oh yeah, no, this is one of the neighbors back in Wisconsin. There are two halves to this baseball, and it's fortunately one of the neighbors back in Wisconsin has a bandsaw, and so I finally, because I didn't have a half a baseball to show off to people for a long time, and I just sort of knocked on his door, and I'm like, can you just? I have this one, and I have a minor league. I should have gotten like more done than just. So I'll, when I'm out there again, I will definitely drag some along and be like, here, cut these in half too.
Yeah, that's awesome. Were your neighbors, did they ask about, were they like, oh, okay, this is weird?
They're fine. It's Wisconsin. Everybody's awesome and nice. But it's actually really interesting because it makes for a really cool, it's like a cool conversation topic.
Yeah.
You know, so many people are already baseball fans. Some of them are aware of this stuff. Some of them aren't, but then they're fascinated when they find out, you know. I'm just amazed that people seem to think this is hard, because it's really not. You know, I sort of, it almost feels like I'm cheating a lot, because I feel like this is a high school science fair project that I've just kind of like exploded into something else. But that's, I mean, like, this is a high school science fair project. I've used a chopstick. I use a kitchen scale. I use calipers, like, that I bought on Amazon for like $30. That's most of it right there.
That's awesome.
It's just, it's not like it's a lot of stuff or even a lot of work, you know?
Yeah, that's really cool though. I mean, just to hear about, and I think this is a one reason, like, I've been interested in talking to you is, one, just, I mean, science, it touches everything.
Yep.
Two, I mean, it's sort of democratized in that way where you can use things you already have or that don't cost much to do right. Things like this. And also, I think how you spoke into the just the interdisciplinary mm-hmm. portion of your work and some of your colleagues' work. It's really cool. Like, you really never know about yep. that. Mm-hmm. I was curious. Go ahead.
I was going to say, I just love the fact that this is science, because I've got a PhD in astrophysics. I know what like the other extreme is, where you're like building a really complicated computer simulation, and that's really cool stuff too. But it's really neat to you know, a lot of this, I'm literally sitting on my bed fighting my cats off, because they're, you know, one of them tries to eat the laces all the time. She's obsessed with baseball laces. I have to be really careful. But this is science. And as long as you can do things in a way that's really consistent and you keep good, in fact, the difference is basically keeping track of your data. That's kind of what it comes down to.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of trial and error, and, you know, there are a lot of things that I started on, you know, that weren't the right way to think about it, you know, and I go back and listen to some of my earlier interviews. I was way off base, no pun intended, on, you know, some, usually making stuff too complicated, frankly. It's if there's one thing that I've learned is that, you know, like, for instance, people wanting nefarious plots.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
Most of what I've found is not, it's not nefarious. If anything, it seems to be people making decisions without understanding that there are consequences to those decisions, which probably sounds familiar.
Yes.
So, but there's a lot to be said for, you probably know the term Occam's razor.
Yep. Yeah. That's what I was thinking.
And that's a lot of this really is that, you know, so like when I come up with a hypothesis for something, very often it's just here. It's not that it's the explanation. It's like when I put out, like, you know, the lace thickness stuff that turned out to actually be the simplest, you know, here's one thing that's changed that is somehow affecting the flight of the ball. By the way, the reason I have baseballs going back so far is because it does look like that lace thickness might relate to home runs.
Okay.
Like, literally, it might, some of the stuff I've looked at, it looks like the thicker laces are in years where that home run rate before 2014.
Before. You know,
thicker laces. Yeah. And so, yeah, so I'm going back, and that's why I'm digging that far back, is because I think there might be something to it, which is kind of cool.
Yeah, that's interesting.
And having, it's always cool when you can have like a single thing that you can point to, or the dryer, you know, it's like, hi, you too can make your own 2019 baseball, literally at home. I want people to do this. I really want people to do this. And like, let me know, or let you know. Yeah, I did it. You know, I soaked the outside, I threw it in the dryer, and yeah, it did what Meredith said it would.
It's a challenge to any listeners. You got to put your baseballs, get them, put them in the dryer, report.
You know what I want? I want like a series of TikTok videos.
That's a great idea.
I probably need to do my own first, but yeah.
That would be pretty awesome. I think you'd have quite a few people, myself included, interested in that if you ever do decide to sign up.
You know what? We should, we've got a break. We've got games delayed. We need to do a TikTok challenge for 2019 baseballs.
This is a great idea.
Yes.
This is a great challenge.
Yeah.
We'll
have to put that out, because, you know, it'll be fun. It will distract people from the horrible things that are going on in the game right now, I hope.
Horrible. Sad. No, I'm kind
players
of
got to do something.
Yeah. I'm on board too.
I was just thinking that they might be the ones who are more likely to have a lot of baseballs around that they can just
toss in.
Right. Cause, you know, a lot of people, if they've got baseballs, they're souvenirs and they don't want to do anything with them.
Right. I know.
I don't blame them.
Yeah. to go buy one.
I've never, you know, if somebody is like, oh yeah, you know, because I'll ask, you know, by the way, are you attached to that baseball? Are you willing to part with that? And if they say no, it's a souvenir, I'm like, no, please keep it. It's much more important to you, because, you know, that's the point. Or I'm astonished, like occasionally I've gotten ones where there's like a signature on it. I'm like, you sure you want to do this?
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah. Well, that's another challenge. Anybody here who has balls that they got from a game don't want to use isn't signed?
Actually, I mean, that's, I guess it's a standard shout out. You know, I mean, hit killing up, or yeah, it's probably the best thing. But yeah, Connect. I mean, anything that people have, Major League Baseballs especially, it's, yeah, I mean, and frankly, I'll take previous years, because of things like, for instance, looking at lace thickness, I can figure out when those were made. And that's really the most important thing. Even if you don't know what year it's from, I'll find out. No,
she will find out. I love that. So I know I've taken a lot of your time and you've been very generous. I do want to ask one more question.
Of course.
Like I mentioned, I've been following you for a while, and in your work with Bradford, it's big because it has potential to rattle some people's cages a little bit and, you know, keep organizations, institutions in check. So I am curious, just you with your experience, as, and correct me if I'm wrong, presumably identifies as a woman, through working in science, working in a field like astrophysics, working in this baseball field, and, you know, working with the MLB or showing your research to them, you know, what's that been like for you? Talking to you, you're like a rock star.
It's the hair. For the people hair who aren't video, the blonde is now blue.
And it looks awesome.
It's fun, yeah. Because pandemic, you know.
It's very cool. Yeah, I mean, what's it been like for you? Do you have takeaways or things you've learned?
You know what's been interesting is, I mean, I guess one of the reasons, part of the reason that I got into baseball as late as I did was frankly because there just wouldn't have been a place for a scientist. That's a remarkably new thing. I think people forget that.
Yeah, that is true.
Like it's been, you know, it's been a decade, but there wasn't a place for me before then. I will admit though, when I was, you know, going to grad school and getting my PhD, it wouldn't have dawned on me that there would have been a place for a woman in a front office at all, because they just weren't there. Mm-hmm. So there's that. And frankly, I've been an official scorer, but I've never been a great ball player. And just because the game is part of me doesn't mean I'm actually good at it. Unfortunately, right. I wish I was, but no, but that my dad got those. I did not. Otherwise it's actually been kind of interesting. And I think it might be not being a journalist and frankly, also just being overeducated. I mean, the first thing is, hi, here's Dr. Meredith Wills. She's an astrophysics PhD. And that's fine. That's who I am. That's like, I spent a lot of time in school to earn that degree, frankly. So anybody who says I'm not entitled to doctor, will talk.
Yeah.
You know, it's a lot more work to get a PhD than to get an MD. Sorry. And I that's not to discount MDs. Just, you know, those of us who worked hard for it, it's okay.
Right. Yeah.
But I think because of that, there's a weird niche. And so I haven't really had problems that I have been able to track back to,
awesome,
you know, being a woman in the sport. It's, you know, I'm not sure it's easy for anyone to come in sideways.
Yeah.
You know, certainly in front offices, it's an intern structure.
Yeah.
So it's like, hi, you know, I spent this entire chunk of my life, and, you know, she spent 10 years in grad, okay, I guess 7 years. But yeah, I mean, she has a lot of time in grad school. So I mean, I was almost 30 at something when I got my PhD.
Yeah.
That's not atypical. That pretty much precludes the whole intern at a undergrad.
Yeah.
So it's happening more now, but for a while, like coming in, not like working your way up from the bottom was not something that was done.
Right.
And so that was probably more of an issue than anything.
Interesting. Okay.
I haven't had within professional baseball, it's actually been great.
That's awesome.
You know, it's nice. You know, I wish it was easier for a lot of people.
Yeah.
You know, I think frankly, not being a journalist has been, I think it's very different if you're a journalist, frankly.
Yeah. Yeah.
So.
But I think, you know, that's great. And the questions you're able to answer, ask, even start asking. They're so hugely valuable. So I think it is good to hear that for people that may be interested, no matter what their background is, that are interested in doing work, even if it's not like yours, but similar, which I know a lot of people might be. It's great to hear that that is achievable.
Mm-hmm. What so much of it has come down, I mean, some of my earliest mentors were retired scouts, which if you can think of, that is the hardest nut to crack. If you are any kind of, you know, analyst or scientist, like that sounds, and as a woman, you know, like that should be the absolute worst, right? But some of my very first mentors, and what struck me at the time, and I feel like this is true across the board, is that it really just came down to me being a baseball person. And people will, you know, there's a lot, like as long as you are a baseball person, I guess it forgives a multitude of sins.
Yeah.
If that makes sense. And it's not just knowing the game. It's, you know, it's respecting what other people's knowledge and skill set, you know, like working as a data scientist, doing analytics, like the one thing I know, I am not a scout. I am not a coach. I get to help them do their job, but yeah, that's not my job. If anything, like it, anybody, if you're going to do analytics or any kind of, you know, data stuff in any sport, your support staff, that's your job. You help other people do theirs, and that's it. So that's, you really kind of have to, you have to kill your ego, which, yeah, seems, can be tough if you, like, you know, have been the kind of person who's been the smartest person in the room. But it's not, you know, it's, if you're a baseball person, and people get that, and, yeah, and that's been huge, you know. So
that's awesome. Have you had that where you have, you know, found something, found data, or proven something that you have evidence for that you could go for with, and maybe suggest it to a coach, anybody really?
I have. I think my favorite story along these lines, though, is it's one thing to find something. It's another to find something and then talk to a player and discover that you've just validated something you already knew. So, like, my favorite story on this, there's a friend of mine who's, he's a, you know, he's a retired major league, he's an all-star center fielder, you know, big power hitter, is retired. And I had recently done a study. It's brilliant, actually. If you find the Sabre Analytics 2020 video online. Okay. My colleague Cameron Adams gave the talk, but we came up with something that's like barrels, except it's looking at hitting against the shift. Huh. By the way, Joey Gallo, LinkedIn, I am really good at being able to, you know, show you how you can hit successfully against the shift using data.
That's awesome. That's awesome.
You know, I won't tell you how to do it, but that's what the data show. It's kind of cool.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, so we did, we called it beats and beat boxes instead of barrel zones. And it's this cool 3D map thing. And it turns out if you want to beat the shift, you don't hit it oppo, you hit it up the middle hard, which is totally not what we expected. Dead center, yeah, middle, slightly left. And so I mentioned this to my friend about, like, how I've done this. And what he basically says is, oh yeah, when I played center field, I found that if, like, I shaded up the middle, just slightly to the left, I could always get these guys. And I'm like,
yeah. Oh, thanks.
I was just like,
thank you for telling me.
So it was great to have validated. It was like, yeah, cool. I have this cool discovery. And he, like, he already knew.
He was like, everybody knows this already. That's cool though. I mean,
there's a reason he was an all-star.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. That's awesome.
I just thought it was so funny when he had that conversation.
Yeah. Like, oh, my work.
But that's, frankly, that's something that really makes you feel good about your work though, is because, you know, there's a couple parts to it. So first of all, it made sense. You're like, I could talk to a ball player and what I said and what I just said here, it makes sense. You hit it, yeah, hard up the middle.
Yeah.
Everybody knows what I'm talking about. I've got data showing you hit it hard up the middle, but ultimately it's data.
Yeah.
And then to be able to talk to a ball player about that and also have it make sense is really pretty cool. So.
Yeah. Yeah. That is cool. You're right. It's like confirmed.
Yep. And it's just the, if you're doing this kind of science, that's what you want. You really want to have, you know, that kind of, just whatever you're doing has to be usable and meaningful. Yeah. And if it's not, then,
yeah. Yeah. And you mentioned repeatable, too, repeatable, mm-hmm, processes, which I,
yep,
think is,
yep,
is an interesting and good point too, especially if anybody
listens. At the very least, you have to, I mean, and the phrase in science is falsifiable. Like every class I ever taught, that day one, if a student remembered nothing from my classes, they would remember falsifiable. And all that means is that you ask a question in a way that somebody else can ask the same question and disprove what you found. Not proof, disprove.
Interesting.
So you always set it up so someone can disprove it.
Yeah.
And that's the whole definition of science in a nutshell is falsifiable.
Interesting.
So, which means you can, you know, take apart baseballs and it could be science.
I love it. It's awesome. Cool. Yep. Well, would you mind sharing where people can find you on Twitter? I will put it in the links and as well as the links to, I'll put it in the links too as well for all of your stories and, you know, Bradford and some of your other colleagues that you mentioned.
Sure.
But yeah, would you mind?
Yeah. So it's, I'm basically on Twitter. I mean, if I have accounts elsewhere, I don't check them. So again, I know people have reached out on Facebook. I'm never on Facebook. Sorry. so it's, that it's baseball astrophysics, which is @BBL_, and then the word astrophysics without an I. And that's just because when I made the handle, it was a character limit and there was no room for an I. But Keelan, is going to, I was literally talking to a friend in Keenan before this. I'm surprised I haven't screwed it up until now. Hi, Keenan. But, Keelan's going to link to it, fortunately, because I don't expect anyone to remember that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'll be sharing with you a lot and hopefully looking for your TikTok challenge to dry balls.
And tell me about all the people who are sending you baseballs.
Yes, absolutely. If you have a baseball from minors, majors, wherever, send the balls. If you connect with either of us, you'll have all of our information and give her the balls, please.
Thank you.
Awesome. All right, Dr. Willis, thank you so much for spending this time here.
This was fun.
And, awesome. You're great. And everybody be on the lookout for Dr. Willis' next set of research in the future. And thank you so much for tuning in with us.
Thanks.
Yeah.